Hello, and welcome to 5 Minutes Postgres. My name is Lucas, and today we'll talk about understanding Postgres IOPS and how Postgres structures its physical table structure. We'll start with this blog post by John Dalton on the Crunchy Data blog. In this blog post, John explains why looking at I/O performance matters even when your data fits into the cache. He starts at this from a high level. When we think about IOPS on database side, you can think of it in a way that the database will have individual processes. Those processes interact with shared buffers in Postgres and the OS page cache, both of which are in memory. And then Postgres will issue I/O requests to the underlying disk storage. That might be locally attached to an actual physical server, or nowadays, in most cases, it's a network request to a network storage. John goes into a few details here on how this all works, but one important thing to remember is that you'll always have IOPS ongoing when Postgres works, because Postgres does writes, for example, to its wall as regular activities are happening, even if most of your workload or all of your workload is in memory. Now, John also describes here a little bit about how we can think about IOPS capacity and burst IOPS. And I think the gist of it is, if you use cloud provider disks, usually they have a certain burst capacity. What that means is, for example, on AWS, if you use their GP2 or GP3 volumes, you'll sometimes have burst behaviors where it will be fast, but at some point you've exceeded your IOPS allocation and things will become slow. So when your database is suddenly slow, it may also make sense to look at these physical properties of the cloud provider's storage to really understand what's going on. Now, the most common situation you'll see when Postgres is slow because of I/O problems is when it's actually waiting on disk I/O. There's ways to get that information by looking at the wait events in Postgres or by looking at the actual I/O wait on the processes. One way that is described here is by using the pgcpu time function provided by the pgproctype extension. This essentially gives you a measurement of what you could get from the server directly as well. Now, as pointed out here, there's various ways of measuring IOPS, but one of the things that you can also do is look at I/O statistics in Postgres. So the most common things that I would use to understand whether I/O is a problem is by looking at the I/O timing information collected by Postgres. That's enabled by using the track I/O timing setting, which depending on your provider may be enabled by default or maybe needs to be turned on. It is something that I would always turn on for production systems unless you have a very slow time source. Now, the other thing that you can do is you can run explain analyze buffers. And if you have track I/O timing enabled, it will give you the I/O timing information as part of the output. Here we can see I/O timings. We can actually know how slow it was to get that data from disk. Again, this would clearly show you a bottleneck on the I/O performance. Now, the other thing I want to point out, and we've talked about this previously in 5 Minutes of Postgres, is pgstat.io. So if you're in Postgres 16, this is a really great improvement that will give you information on what part of your database was slow. Another post I want to briefly touch upon is a great tip that Nikolay from Postgres AI recently wrote about, where he explains how Postgres stores tuples in a table. Here he walks through some of the physical on-disk structure. And really the thing to remember is that ultimately Postgres data is stored in pages. We can actually know where in the page that information is. If we query the hidden CTID column, it will tell us the physical location of a tuple in a table. If running a query like this, can actually add the CTID into our query, and this way you will know where in a table your data actually lies. Now, why does that matter for I/O performance? Because if you're loading a lot of pages, if your data is essentially spread across a lot of different pages in your table, that means that it will be slower to load data. However, if you have your data densely packed in a smaller amount of pages, then it will be faster to load that same data. Postgres doesn't load individual rows. Postgres will always load the full page. Where your data is located in a table matters greatly for efficiency. At the end of this tip, Nikolay describes how you can improve the packing of your tuples, of your rows into the pages in a Postgres database. First of all, it's always a good idea to maintain tables indexes in good shape. That means make sure you watch out for table bloat, make sure you do index maintenance, you do regular reindexes. That will make sure that your pages don't have empty space in them. Another thing that sometimes happens is if you rely on index-only scans, that way you're not going back to the table and you're just accessing less pages. And then last, there is a way to structure your table in a way that will actually group data together. And so that way, if you know that you're always sorting by a particular column, it may make sense to cluster your table. Now, cluster is unfortunately a command that takes a full table lock, but you can use the pgrepack command to achieve the same in an online fashion. This will often give you a huge performance benefit, but is a bit tedious to maintain. All in all, the physical data structure matters as much as your server configuration to achieve the best I/O performance in Postgres. Thank you so much for listening. This was 5 Minutes of Postgres. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear about next week's episode, and talk to you next week.